Let's recap the shapers of worldviews. In other words, what are the sources of answers the worldview provides to big questions? The first point here, I list up here is major worldviews provide answers to the foundational questions, as we already checked, okay? And such worldviews are in turn shaped by people's religions and dominant political economic ideologies, such as Buddhism, Buddhist worldview, animism, animist worldview, modernity worldview, postmodernity worldview.
Okay? Even communism.
Communism also, we'll come to that, okay? I cannot list all of this here, okay? So these are just representative, okay? Important things, okay? All right, yeah. Example, I give a little more here. Okay, yeah. The religions and ideologies behind East Asian worldviews are Buddhism, Confucianism. Since it's East Asian, it doesn't have Hinduism, but if it's Asia, then Hinduism should go in, right? And modern natural materialism, both the secular humanism and material Marxism, okay? You see, two branches of modern ideologies, which are coming from natural materialism, are secular humanism and material Marxism, which in other words called also communism and socialism, okay? And now postmodernism, postmodernity, which is more important these days, particularly for young people these days, okay? Now, as our study of worldview in general, let's check out evaluation criteria of worldviews. Somehow we need to evaluate worldviews, okay? And for that purpose, evaluation criteria and evaluation principle are very important, okay? And these are those principles and the criteria. The first one is kind of a principle which says a fair and objective evaluation of worldviews, not depending on views of a religion or an ideology, is necessary unless one believes in a thorough relativism which accepts all worldviews are relative. Okay, I think this is a loaded kind of a statement, and I need to explain a little bit. All right. We all know that we need to somehow evaluate worldviews, okay? But then, the most important principle of that is that this evaluation should be based on generally acceptable principles, okay? Not entirely based on teaching of a religion or an ideology, okay? You see, of course, we all know that the biblical truth is the answer, okay? But that's only for only among Christians, okay? But if you say this is evaluation result following what Bible teaches, then those people who are not Christians, they would say, no way, you know, that's a Christian teaching and I'm not into it and I'm not interested in it, okay? They'll turn away, all right? So we need an objective and fair evaluation worldview. Not depending on a view of a religion or an ideology, okay? And that's very necessary. And we need to do an evaluation unless we are a thorough relativist, okay? If you are a thorough relativist, then there's no need to evaluate because everything is relative. Everything is okay, all right? So there's no point of evaluating, all right? There are many people who are relativists these days, okay? Cultural relativism, you know, religious relativism, all that. Those are dangerous things, okay? Among us, all right? But there are many people who are like that, okay? So unless one is a thorough relativist, one needs to somehow do evaluation, okay? Following an objective evaluation principle using evaluation criteria, okay? Criteria, sorry, all right? For the criteria, philosophy of religion provides three evaluation criteria. You see, this is a philosophy, discipline of a philosophy of religion, not Christian faith or Buddhist religion, right? So following philosophy of religion, which is an established discipline of, study, there are three evaluation criteria which are deemed fair and objective, okay? First one is internal system integrity. Second one is effectiveness in existential problem solving or salvation from enigma and misery of life. And lastly, moral assessment, okay? I will explain a little more in the following slide here, okay? The first point, internal system integrity, okay? The integrity of internal coherence, consistency within a set of beliefs and assumptions of the worldview concerned. What it says is basically this, okay? Worldview being such teaches a lot, okay? Comes up with many assumptions and many beliefs, okay? There are many, many teachings and many, many doctrines even, okay? One good example is Hinduism. If you read the Hindu, books, and the Indians are quite often, they are very proud of that. You know what they say? In our religion, that's Hinduism, everything is there. Even Jesus is mentioned, right? Everything is there, no doubt about it, okay? But then, what does Hinduism lack? What, Hinduism has a problem with is they don't have internal consistency, internal coherence. Here they talk something this and then there are something entirely different, okay? Even contradictions, many, many there. So there is no internal integrity or coherence or consistency within a set of beliefs and presuppositions of the worldview. I mean, this is very, very important, all right? Related to that is the exclusion of a self-defeating statement or contradiction. In philosophy, you know what contradiction means, right? Contradiction means you say, something here. You say A is, for example, square. And then in here, you say A is circular. That's a contradiction, okay? A cannot be both, circular and square, right? So that's a contradiction. Same thing is, stated entirely differently. That's a contradiction. Paradox is a bit different, okay? Paradox seems contradictory, but it's not contradiction. So, there are many even paradoxes in the Bible, actually, but that's not contradiction, okay? And this exclusion or self-defeating statement or contradiction, the same goes for freedom from ad hoc hypothesis. If teaching or doctrine of worldview, comes up with a lot of different hypotheses, assumptions, ad hoc, okay? Not consistently, but depending on need, they come up with another hypothesis, they come up with another, presuppositions. Those are ad hoc hypotheses. Should be free from that kind of thing, okay? If you have that kind of thing, many then, the teaching, something is wrong, right? And another thing is, the important thing is the consistency with the knowledge in other fields. For example, history. History is a factual science, right? If, what the worldview teaches is entirely different from what history says, something wrong there, okay? It's not consistent with, knowledge in history, okay? So, should be consistent with the knowledge in other fields, established, disciplines. This is a very important first criterion, integrity of internal coherence, consistency, okay? And second one, which is more actually practical and more relevant for our preaching and teaching, second one is a provision of solutions to existential problems, such as illness, sufferings, evils, and death, including salvation, okay? Teachings, doctrines of worldview should provide salvation, should provide the solutions to these problems. We have so many problems, including, problem of death, okay? problem of misery of life and sufferings and all that, teachings of a worldview should provide answers to that. That's salvation, right? So if a worldview provides a salvation, then it is a good worldview, right? Worthy, you know, to work with, okay? If it does not, then why do you bother, okay? Third one, moral integrity of teachings and practices of worldview. Okay, moral integrity. This is another very, very important criterion because, you know, if a person is not moral, that person's, you know, of course, we cannot talk of, you know, holiness or spiritual being of that person. He acts like an animal, all right? So morality is a very, very important part of it. And some worldviews, some religions do not teach, you know, acceptable morality, for example, right? Compared to that, Christian religion, Christian faith teaches set of, you know, moralities, because our God is a moral God, okay? Holy God and good God. Sure, they have an entirely different set of morality. Another good example, this time again, Hinduism, for example. Do you think Hinduism is a moral religion? No, I don't think so. You know why? Hindu teaching, if you follow that, you have to live in a caste, right? Caste system. And if you follow Hindu teaching, then you have to practice sati, right? You know what sati means? If a husband dies, then the wife of that husband should be put on fire. Okay? That's sati, right? Indian constitution, of course, you know, abolished that. But then deep inside India, many people still follow that, still practice that. That's the morality of Hindu teaching, okay? There's no morality there. Okay? So, morality. And here I pointed out this one because this is important. The conformity with the universal morals of a there is a universal morals. Okay? Moral is not something, you know, is determined by a person's religion or culture. There are some morals which are beyond, you know, all these different religions and cultures. Those are universal, like universal right, okay? Human right. There are universal morals. For example, prohibition of unjustified killing of other humans. This is immoral thing by all, you know, seemingly good religions, okay? And injury to others. This is immoral, okay? Deception, immoral, okay? You know, those people, group which lives by deception? Gypsy people, okay? You know, thousand years, they've been living their lives by deception, okay? By deceiving their identity and where they are coming from, okay? There are some people who live by deception, okay? Which is immoral. Lying and cheating, of course. Immoral, okay? And inappropriate sexual relations, okay? These are accepted universal morals, okay? The last point here, inappropriate sexual relations.
Man to man. But it is already becoming accepted by the world.
Sure, gay, LGBT, all these things. Yeah, this is against this, okay?
Momentum.
Sure, sure. And you know, have you heard of hookup culture? Hookup culture, hookup, H-O-K, up culture, hookup culture, hookup culture. Mm. Check it out on Google, okay? Hookup culture is a culture of the day by which one can enjoy sex in any way, you know, available, you know, without any moral, any concern, anything. You just enjoy, you know, whatever, wherever there is a sexual encounter, you know, you just enjoy it, okay? That's the hookup culture against this teaching here. Very immoral. That's very much part of, you know, what postmodernity teaches, okay? In the name of freedom, in the name of a subjective emotion, they do anything, okay? They enjoy their sex, and then if they are, you know, if there is a child born, then you know what they do? They throw away. That's what, you know, Francis, Pope Francis years ago called, you know, throwaway culture. He deplored that, okay? Moral integrity is very important. Our Christian faith, from the start, it's very moral, you know, good moral teachings, okay?
Amen.
Not other religions, okay? A little problems there, okay? Anyway, these are important three criteria. Usually, two criteria they talk, you know, researchers and commentators, but in that case, second one includes both, okay? Provision of a solution and the moral assessment. But I go by these three, this is better actually, because moral integrity is so important against what we see today, right? Gay movement, you know, LGBT and hookup culture, what have you, okay? This is a terrible, terrible, you know, immoral age. And so, you know, this is important evaluation. Okay?